when talking about WrestleMania, whether it be greatest matches or in this case greatest moments, you can't talk about WrestleMania without talking about Macho Man Randy Savage versus Ricky the Dragon Steamboat for the Intercontinental Championship at WrestleMania 3. In terms of matches, this is easily one of the greatest matches in WrestleMania history, and in terms of moments, it's easily a top 10 moment in WrestleMania history. When you hear the terms of five-star classic or show stealer, terms like that, those terms were spawned because of this match here. Sure, you had matches like this prior to WrestleMania 3 in the WWF. However, those matches were usually relegated to popcorn matches at various live events across the country. See the series of matches between Tiger Mask and the Dynamite Kid. Those matches were great. However, they were popcorn matches that nobody really cared about. The difference between those matches and this match here was this match was given great hype, great build, an amazing story. The platform of WrestleMania in the Pontiac Silverdome in front of 93,000 fans, and to top it all off, the match was for the Intercontinental Championship, back at a time when the IC title actually meant something. You still see fingerprints of this match in just about every big match today. You know the matches I'm talking about, the near fall fests, where it's near fall after near fall after near fall. You see dozens of near falls. That spawned from Randy Savage versus Ricky Steamboat. This match has so much impact in today's business, and it's almost 30 years old. And in 2014, it's still as great as it was back in 1987. This match had a big impact in pro wrestling. Without this match, you would have never seen the smaller, more athletic, the quote-unquote real wrestlers been given opportunities to shine in the limelight. This match is an all-time WrestleMania classic, an all-time WWE classic, and an all-time professional wrestling classic. The match was great, and the build-up was great. This was the injury angle done right. Savage crushed Steamboat's throat on the guard railing with a ring bell. Steamboat was carried off on a stretcher. He was gone for a while. They showed vignettes of him trying to get his voice back. He eventually did get his voice back. He returned a few months later to confront Savage, wanting revenge on Savage for crushing his throat. The match between the two was set for WrestleMania 3 for the Intercontinental Championship, and again, I don't have to emphasize this again. You already know how great this match was. This was an all-time classic. However, the misconception about this match is that it was this 25, 30-minute epic classic. This match went 14 and a half minutes. That's a testament of how great Savage and Steamboat truly are. The fact that they did all they did, the great moves, the 19 near falls, the fact they did all of that in 14 and a half minutes is a testament of how great those two really are. Savage, one of the all-time greats. Steamboat, one of the all-time greats. And after 14 and a half minutes, 19 near falls, Steamboat rolls Savage up to capture the Intercontinental Championship, ending Savage's year-plus reign as the Intercontinental Champion. An all-time WrestleMania match and an all-time WrestleMania moment. While this wasn't the end of an era because Undertaker and Triple H are both still wrestling, this was the end, the culmination of a four WrestleMania story arc between Undertaker and D-Generation X. Now, truth be told, this wasn't the plan all along. This wasn't this master plan that started at WrestleMania 25 that was going to culminate at WrestleMania 28 between Undertaker and Triple H in a Hell in a Cell with Shawn Michaels as the special guest referee. However, it inadvertently became the plan as time went on. 25 built to 26, which built to 27, which built to 28. And the funny thing is, nobody wanted to see another Undertaker Triple H WrestleMania match. There was one at 17 that the WWE never mentioned. They built the 27 match as like a first time ever match. And then the 27 match, while a good match, is the weakest of the four match story arc. However, as much as nobody wanted to see another Undertaker Triple H match, the second it became a Hell in a Cell match, all those people that were like, no, I don't want to see it, they became, yeah, I want to see this. It's a Hell in a Cell. It's Undertaker and Triple H, the two masters of the Hell in a Cell, having a Hell in a Cell match at WrestleMania. Who wouldn't want to see that? Wait, Rock and Cena are the main event? Fuck that. Undertaker Triple H should be the main event. That should be the main event. It's like everyone forgot about Cena Rock and they solely focused on Undertaker and Triple H in the Hell in a Cell. And to top that, Shawn Michaels was made the special guest referee. So not only do we have the two masters of the Hell in a Cell having a Hell in a Cell match at WrestleMania, but the third master of the Hell in a Cell match, the one who won the first Hell in a Cell match against The Undertaker, who had a Hell in a Cell match against Triple H in 2004, is the special guest referee. Three of the biggest names in WrestleMania history under one, literal one roof. And hell, this was effectively a handicap match because you know Shawn Michaels' track record as a special referee is always horrible. They bring it up every time Shawn Michaels is a special guest referee. Why the hell is Shawn Michaels ever a special guest referee? Because he always stirs up controversy. So we knew Undertaker was going to win, but there was always that slim doubt that he's going to lose, but at the end, we all know he was going to win. Regardless of predictability, from bell to bell, this is one of the best matches in WrestleMania history. Yeah, it's not a 4 out of 10, Brett. It's a 10 out of 10. This had story. This had emotion. This had everything you would want in a professional wrestling match. The ride, the roller coaster of emotions throughout this match makes this match 5 stars in my book. And while it was effectively a handicap match, Undertaker, of course, won, extended the streak to 20-0, and then after the match, Undertaker and Shawn carries Triple H up the ramp, and at the top, the three had a group hug. It was the perfect end for this. The perfect end to a 4-year story arc. Not the end of an era, because, of course, Undertaker and Triple H are still wrestling. However, for the end of a 4-year WrestleMania story arc, a group hug was the perfect way to end. Now, it's kind of a damn shame it wasn't the last match of Undertaker and Triple H's career, because had it been the last match, this would be way higher up there, because it would have truly been the end of an era. However, it was the end of a story arc, a 4 WrestleMania story arc between Undertaker and D-Generation X, regardless of it being last matches or not. This was a great moment in WrestleMania history. The relationship of Macho Man Randy Savage and Miss Elizabeth is the greatest in the history of professional wrestling. Because regardless of the highs and the lows, the peaks and the valleys, the good times, the bad times, whether they had everything or nothing at all, the one thing they at least had was each other. And that was evident here at WrestleMania 7. Even though on screen her and Savage had been apart for 2 years, Miss Elizabeth always had a place in her heart for Macho Man Randy Savage. She was in the crowd for the Savage Warrior retirement match, and every time something bad happened to Savage, they would pan into the crowd and show the emotion on Elizabeth's face. Because again, regardless of everything that happened, she always had a place in her heart for Randy Savage. And speaking of the Savage Warrior retirement match, it's one of the greatest matches in WrestleMania history. It's kind of a damn shame it doesn't get the credit it truly deserves. It's an all-time WrestleMania classic. Warrior's greatest match. One of Savage's greatest matches. Again, kind of a damn shame it doesn't get the credit it truly deserves. You get the ending where Savage hits 5 elbow drops, still can't keep the Warrior down. Warrior eventually gets the win, and Savage's career was quote-unquote over. This was before retirement angles became the whole cliched bullshit, unless you're Shawn Michaels. This, you know, fans actually thought Randy Savage's career was over. So Savage lost and his career was quote-unquote over. And Sensational Queen Sherry was pissed. She was Savage's manager. Savage was her meal ticket. Savage lost. His career was over. Sherry lost her meal ticket and proceeded to take advantage of a fallen Randy Savage. And what'd she do? She literally kicked Savage while he was down. And Miss Elizabeth in the crowd, she took all she could until she couldn't take anymore. She proceeded to jump the guardrail, get into the ring, and throw Sensational Sherry out of the ring. Which was huge, because Miss Elizabeth didn't do much, but she always made an impact. But she rarely ever got physical. She was unlike other valets of her time and of all time. So she throws Sensational Sherry out of the ring. Savage gets up, looks, and was shocked to see what Miss Elizabeth did, because the way Savage treated her and just everything that had happened over the last couple years, Miss Elizabeth was the last person Savage ever expected to help him out. But again, no matter what had happened, no matter the good times and the bad times, Savage and Elizabeth always had each other. The two hugged. Savage went from a top villain to a top good guy instantly. And fans, they were so invested in the Savage-Elizabeth relationship that they panned to women crying in the crowd. And those fans weren't plants. They were legitimately crying because they were invested in the Savage-Elizabeth relationship. This all led to eventually the on-screen wedding of Savage and Elizabeth at SummerSlam 1991. Granted, they had been legit married for many years up to this point, but on TV, they never acknowledged that. They were just manager and protege. They never mentioned anything about a relationship up until here. If you're an old school fan, you know why this moment is on here. This is truly one of the most emotional moments, not just in WrestleMania history, but professional wrestling history as a whole. The reunion of Macho Man Randy Savage and Miss Elizabeth at WrestleMania 7. This is the old Yeller moment of professional wrestling. Shawn Michaels telling Ric Flair, "I'm sorry, I love you," then super kicking him, pinning him 1-2-3, and ending his career. This was a moment that is hard to forget. Now, sure, it's kind of tainted because of Ric Flair's TNA run. Regardless of that, this moment is still one of those big-time moments in WrestleMania history. On November 26, 2007, Ric Flair returned from a few-month hiatus and made a declaration, "I will never retire." Vince McMahon retaliated that declaration with a declaration of his own. The next time Ric Flair lost a match, Ric Flair would have to retire from professional wrestling. So every time Ric Flair had a singles match, a one-on-one match, it would be a career-threatening match. And Ric Flair survived many career-threatening matches over the next couple months. We get to WrestleMania season, and Ric Flair was announced to be the headliner of the 2008 Hall of Fame class, being the first active in-ring wrestler to be inducted. And also during that time, Ric Flair challenged Shawn Michaels for WrestleMania 24. He said point blank, he knows his career cannot last forever, but if he has to lose at WrestleMania 24, it would be an honor for his career to end against Shawn Michaels. After much reluctance, Shawn Michaels accepts the challenge. And Shawn had a lot of reluctance because Ric Flair was Shawn's hero. All legit, Ric Flair was Shawn Michaels' favorite wrestler growing up, so Shawn would have a lot of reluctance to end Ric Flair's career. But again, after much reluctance, Shawn Michaels accepts the challenge. Now, the match between these two at WrestleMania 24 is no technical classic by any means. Ric Flair looked like absolute shit. Shawn Michaels had to moonsault and bump, and Shawn Michaels, I hate to say, wrestled a sandbag, but just look at the match. It's no technical classic by any means. However, the storytelling, the emotion, everything involved with this match, Ric Flair versus Shawn Michaels was a memorable WrestleMania match. And after a second sweet chin music, Ric Flair, still fighting, still gets up, gets on his knees, begs for another sweet chin music. Shawn Michaels is torn, he's reluctant, but Ric Flair said to Shawn he wants Shawn's best. So Shawn, torn as hell, has that look on his face and tells Ric Flair, "I'm sorry, I love you," super kicks him, pins him for the 1-2-3, and you could tell that this was part work and part shoot, because again, Flair was Shawn's idol. This meant a lot for Shawn Michaels. It only seemed right that Shawn would end Flair's career. And afterwards, Shawn quickly hugs Flair, leaves, gives Flair his moment. Flair gets his send-off the next night on Raw. That entire weekend for WrestleMania was all about Ric Flair. Again, it's kind of a damn shame he had to go to TNA and kind of ruin this, but regardless of his TNA run, Ric Flair, this moment right here, was an awesome moment, one of the most memorable moments in WrestleMania history. This moment for me and a lot of other wrestling fans is really painful to go back and watch, go back and relive, because to think 10 years later, both Chris Benoit and Eddie Guerrero are dead. And to think, because of what Chris Benoit did, this moment can no longer be celebrated, can no longer be remembered. However, when talking about great moments and talking about great WrestleMania endings, you cannot talk about great WrestleMania endings, as painful as it is. You can't talk about a great WrestleMania ending without talking about Chris Benoit and Eddie Guerrero celebrating both as world champions at the end of WrestleMania 20. 10 years ago, this was the true wrestling fan's greatest moment. Two quote-unquote real wrestlers holding up world titles at the end of WrestleMania in Madison Square Garden. Triple H, Shawn Michaels, and Kurt Angle put these two over in a big way. Both Benoit and Guerrero were world-traveled wrestlers. Both competed in Japan and ECW and WCW and now the WWE. These two were friends. They were as close as friends as you could get. And these two were two wrestlers who were told they would never make it past a certain level in wrestling. They would never break through the glass ceiling. Guerrero, in any promotion he had ever been in, was the second tier champion, whether it be US champ, TV champ, Intercontinental champ, you name it. He was good enough for the second tier title, but he was never good enough to be the world champion. And sure, Benoit technically was a former WCW champion. I don't really count that because A, it was for only one day, and B, it was a bargaining chip to keep him in WCW. That's another story for another day. The point is, both Guerrero and Benoit were told they would never make it past a certain level. However, by 2004, a lot of things had changed, and both guys had more than earned their spot at the top. Benoit won the Royal Rumble and in a loophole went from SmackDown to Raw and challenged the World Heavyweight Championship held by Triple H. Eddie Guerrero won the SmackDown Rumble and earned a shot against Brock Lesnar for the WWE Championship at No Way Out and beat Lesnar at No Way Out. Now, some may say they should have waited a month and Guerrero should have won the title at Mania. Well, if he would have won it at Mania, that maybe would have outshined Benoit's moment winning the world title. Plus, they had to deal with Brock's situation and the fact they had to do Brock and Goldberg at WrestleMania. Guerrero winning the title was what it was. So heading into WrestleMania, they put Guerrero in a feud with Kurt Angle, which, that's nothing to frown upon, because by 2004, Kurt Angle was considered one of the best the WWE had ever had, and he had only been in the company for 4 or 5 years. So Guerrero was in a feud with Angle over the WWE Championship. Benoit was challenging Triple H and Shawn Michaels for the World Heavyweight Championship. Shawn Michaels finagled his way in because he felt he was still worthy of being number one contender after a few draws between him and Triple H. So for the WWE Championship, Eddie Guerrero and Kurt Angle. For the World Heavyweight Championship, Chris Benoit, Triple H, and Shawn Michaels. Earlier in the night, Guerrero beat Angle to retain the WWE Championship, and in the main event, Chris Benoit defeated Shawn Michaels and Triple H to win the World Heavyweight Championship. After Benoit wins the title, he's celebrating. Right there is Eddie Guerrero with the WWE Championship, and at that moment, the careers of Chris Benoit and Eddie Guerrero flashed before the fans' eyes. The hard work, the dedication, the triumphs against all odds. Finally, both Benoit and Guerrero broke through the glass ceiling. Both of them are world champions. The show ends with both of them celebrating. The confetti falls from Madison Square Garden. Such a great moment in 2004. 10 years later, it's painful to go back and watch. It's painful to relive. Because not only are both Chris Benoit and Eddie Guerrero dead, but because of what Chris Benoit did, this moment can no longer be celebrated by the WWE, can no longer be remembered by the WWE. However, again, when talking about great WrestleMania moments, especially great WrestleMania endings, you cannot talk about great WrestleMania endings without talking about the celebration of Chris Benoit and Eddie Guerrero at the end of WrestleMania 20.